Hey guys, welcome to the Command Valley. I'm your host Landon, thanks for tuning in. Today's episode will be our final upgrade video for the 2020 Ikoria Commander Precons, which is Timeless Wisdom. Before we get into today's video, I'd like to give a huge shout out to this channel's sponsor, GameGrid Lehigh. Their store is awesome. They've got a huge card archive, so they're going to have all the cards you need, huge selection on card accessories and deck boxes, an amazing and friendly staff, and if you are interested in other board games or Warhammer, they've got a huge selection on stuff for that as well. Additionally, if you haven't subscribed to our channel yet and you like our content, we'd really appreciate it if you hit that subscribe button. It's free, it's quick, it's easy, it helps us out a lot, and you'll stay in the loop with our weekly deck techs and our monthly gameplay videos. Now, with that out of the way, let's dive into today's episode. Like I said, this is an upgrade video for the Precon Timeless Wisdom. The reason why we make these videos and we think that they're relevant is these precons are built and designed to play with the other precons. So they're basically meant to be played with the other precons out of the box. So in this video, I'm going to be going over the cards that you can take out and the cards that you can put in to take this from a out of the box precon only meant to be played with the other precons to a deck that will be a little bit more consistent and a little bit more powerful in other metas. Now, let's go over the theme of the Timeless Wisdom deck so we can kind of understand what the deck wants to do, why we're taking out certain cards, and why we're putting those cards in. So the commander of the deck is Gavi Nestwarden. She costs 2, a blue, a red, and a white, and she is a legendary creature human shaman. And she reads, you may pay 0 rather than pay the cycling cost of the first card you cycle each turn. And whenever you draw your second card each turn, you create a 2/2 red and white dinosaur cat creature token. And she is a 2/5. So this deck is pulling you in two different directions. One is cycling, and we'll go over that mechanic in a second. And two, drawing a bunch of cards so you can make a bunch of 2/2 tokens every turn. If you're unfamiliar with the mechanic cycling, I'll give you an example of it. In the deck, there's a card called Valiant Rescuer. It's a human soldier that costs 1 and a white. And if it's in your hand, you can activate its cycling ability that costs 2 generic, and it says discard this card, draw a card. And that is essentially what cycling is. It's an ability on a card that can only be activated from your hand, and you discard it and draw a card when you pay its cycling cost. Now, there are cycling cards that have other effects that do something different when you cycle it, but essentially that's what it is. You're cycling that card away to get a different card into your hand. So this mechanic, cycling on its own, isn't super lethal. It's meant as a value engine. It's a way of getting rid of cards that you don't need that aren't super relevant right now to getting cards into your hand that are relevant and can help you out in certain situations. There isn't really a way of flat out winning the game by cycling X amount of cards unless you have a way of cycling your whole deck away and winning with Laboratory Maniac or Thassa's Oracle, but we're not going to be doing that. So now that we've got the general gist of the deck, we're going to be cycling away cards, we're going to be drawing cards, we're going to be making tokens, and hopefully winning with those tokens. Let's go over the cards that we're taking out. I'm not going to be going over and reading every single one of these cards, mostly just because we're taking them out. So my criteria for cutting cards out of the deck was if it didn't say cycling directly on it, or if it was kind of a slow card and required a lot of build around in a really particular board state, I'm just taking it out of the deck. So we're taking out Cryptic Trilobite, Agitator Ant, Portal Mage, Brawlin, Sky Shark Raider, Shabraz, the Sky Shark, Akeem, the Soaring Wind, Bonder's Ornament, Chandra Flamecaller, the Impetuous Cycle, which is the 3 enchantments that each have something to do with attacking, Asperia, Supreme Judge, and Niv-Mizzet, the Firemind. Now, these last two, you can keep these two in the deck. I think it's kind of meta-dependent. I find them to be just a little bit too slow, and by that point in time in the game, I think we should be setting up a win, and both of these cards are both value engines, and being not having green, we don't have a whole lot of mana ramp, so being 6 mana each is kind of a lot, but if you really like them and they would do well in your meta, definitely keep them in. Now let's go over the cards we are going to be adding. We're adding 13 cards in since we took 13 out. I'm going to keep the mana base pretty much the same. You don't really want to mess with the mana base too much. Now starting off, let's go over the cards that we're putting in that make us tokens. So since Gavi makes us tokens, when we draw cards, we want to be playing other ways of making tokens as well. So Nadir Kraken is 1 blue-blue for a Kraken, and it says whenever you draw a card, you may pay 1 colorless mana, and if you do, you get to put a +1/+1 counter on Nadir Kraken and create a 1/1 blue tentacle creature token. So this rewards us for doing things that we're already wanting to do in this deck, drawing a bunch of cards. And if we have that extra mana, we can pump it into Nadir Kraken. It gets a little bigger and we can make another token. Then we've got Chasm Skulker, which for 2 and a blue is a creature squid horror, and whenever you draw a card, you put a +1/+1 counter on Chasm Skulker, and when Chasm Skulker dies, you create X11 blue squid creature tokens with Island Walk, where X is the number of +1/+1 counters on Chasm Skulker. So it's not unlikely that we can draw, you know, 2-3 cards per turn, putting 2-3 counters on Chasm Skulker, and when it finally dies, whether our opponents kill it because it's getting huge, or for whatever reason, we're going to get that card draw back essentially in squid tokens. Next up, we've got Improbable Alliance, which is an enchantment that I love a lot. It costs red and a blue, and it says whenever you draw your second card each turn, you create a 1/1 blue fairy creature token with flying. So similarly to Gavi, we have to have drawn 2 cards in 1 turn, but we get a fairy out of it. Improbable Alliance also has an activated ability that says pay 4, a blue and a red to draw a card and discard a card. Now that's a little bit of an overcosted ability, but being able to sink your mana late game into this and make a bunch of fairies could come in clutch. And then our next token maker is a super cool goblin from Throne of Eldraine with Mad Ratter. It costs 3 and a red, and it's a goblin, and it says whenever you draw your second card each turn, create 2 1/1 black rat creature tokens. So like Gavi and Improbable Alliance, it cares about us drawing 2 cards in a turn. Unlike them, it's going to give us 2 tokens rather than 1, so it's super efficient. Now for card advantage, I've put in Drawn from Dreams and Dig Through Time. They're basically the same ability, except for Dig Through Time has an initial higher mana cost, but you can delve away cards from your graveyard to reduce that cost, and both of them get you 7 cards deep into your library and let you get 2 cards from among them and put them right into your hand. I love these cards a lot, and I put them in as many blue decks as I can. It's just super solid card selection and card advantage, and oftentimes can help you find the right card that you need. We're then playing Windfall, which costs 2 and a blue and is a sorcery that says, each player discards their hand and then draws cards equal to the greatest amount of cards discarded this way. Now, there is a sub-theme within the deck, with a lot of creatures caring about us discarding cards, and also drawing a bunch of cards, like Psychosis Crawler. Every time we draw a card, each opponent is going to lose a life. We also have Surly Badgersaur, which every time we discard a card, we're going to get some type of value out of it. Whether it's a creature, we get a +1/+1 counter on it. If it's a land, we get to make a treasure. And if it's a non-creature, non-land card, he can fight a creature that we don't control. So that's a ton of value out of discarding our whole hand, and we've also got ways of getting some cards back from our graveyard into our hand, so it's not a big deal that we're discarding them. And also we're going to be drawing, you know, 5-6 cards depending on how many cards are in our opponent's hands or how many cards we discard at that point. Next up, I'd like to kind of go over our backup win con, our plan B, and that is Approach of the Second Sun. This is probably the only dead card that I'm putting in, and probably the only dead card in the deck. But it's a card that I think is super interesting, and it's a card that I'd like to see work, and it's a sorcery that costs 6 and a white, and if Approach of the Second Sun was cast from your hand, and you've cast another spell named Approach of the Second Sun this game, you win the game. Otherwise, put Approach of the Second Sun into its owner's library, 7th from the top, and you gain 7 life. The reason why this is our backup win con and we're not trying to go all out on the Approach of the Second Sun deck is we're not really playing any ways of consistently making it so we have Approach of the Second Sun in our hand, and even if we cast it, we're going to have to cycle away a bunch of cards from our hand to get it soon enough because it's going 7 cards deep into our library. But if, let's say, Gavi has been killed a bunch of times and you can't afford a caster from the command zone anymore, and your board has been wiped a couple of times, a lot of your key creatures and key pieces are in your graveyard, and it's looking a little bleak, this could be your way out and your way of winning the game. Next up, we have Bag of Holding, which is an artifact that costs 1 generic mana, and whenever you discard a card, exile that card from your graveyard. It then has 2 activated abilities, one that costs 2 and tap, and it says draw a card, then discard a card. Then, for 4 and tapping it, we can sacrifice Bag of Holding to return all cards exiled with it to their owner's hand. Bag of Holding could be nuts in this deck. Let's say you've cycled away, you know, 6 cards in a turn cycle. They all go underneath Bag of Holding. You can crack Bag of Holding and get all those cards back into your hand. So Bag of Holding kind of mitigates that risk of having to discard away cards with cycling. Cards that could maybe be useful late game but aren't really useful now. But with Bag of Holding, you can get those cards back and use them when the time is appropriate. We're then playing Countervailing Winds as some more interaction. It's a counter spell that costs 2 and a blue, and it says counter target spell unless its controller pays 1 generic mana for each card in your graveyard. It also has cycling for 2 mana. So with this deck, we are going to have a ton of cards in our graveyard with the amount of cycling that we're doing, and oftentimes our opponents are not going to want to pay 15 mana, or they're not even going to be able to pay the 15 mana. I'm using 15 as an arbitrary number. It's probably going to be anywhere between, like I said, 5 to 15, and that's a ton of mana. It's just a really good counter spell in this deck. And it has cycling, so if it's not useful right now, you can cycle it away and draw a new card. Next up, We have Unpredictable Cyclone. It's an enchantment that costs 3 red-red, and it says, if a cycling ability of another non-land card would cause you to draw a card, instead exile cards from the top of your library until you exile a card that shares a card type with the cycled card. You may cast that card without paying its mana cost. Then, put the exiled cards that weren't cast this way on the bottom of your library in a random order, and it also has cycling for 2 mana. This is one of the cards I'm most excited about from the Ikoria standard set, and this is the first time in the history of Commander precons that the precons are actually in the same plane and basically the same set as the standard set. There are a lot of cycling goodies from the Ikoria standard set that weren't included in the precons, and this is one of them. Now, this is a very red ability. The card advantage in red is usually what they call an impulse draw or impulse ability, which means you trade away having the card in your hand or drawing the card for being able to cast it right then and there from your library, which can open up some super cool lines of play. I think that there are a lot of different lines of play, probably almost limitless lines of play that you can do with Unpredictable Cyclone. You can cycle away a smaller creature and then end up with a much larger creature, or you can cycle away a small little cantrip, maybe Countervailing Winds or one of the other smaller instants and sorceries, and end up with maybe Approach of the Second Sun, or maybe a Chroma's Vengeance, or Boon of the Wish Giver, or Descend Upon the Sinful. I mean, these are big mana spells, and all you did to cast them was cycle away a smaller card. So the ceiling is super high, and it really is kind of random, but I think that kind of embodies what Commander is. And the last card that we're putting in is Zerda the Dawnbringer, and this is another card from the Ikoria standard set, and it's a super cool card. It's a legendary creature, Elemental Fox, that costs 1 hybrid Boros, hybrid Boros, and it says, abilities you activate that aren't mana abilities cost 2 less to activate. This effect can't reduce the mana in that cost to less than 1. So basically, with Zerda on the battlefield, all of our cycling abilities cost 2 less. It's very similar to another card in the deck that is Fluctuator, and that costs 2 mana, and it says cycling abilities you activate cost up to 2 less to activate. So having that extra redundancy in the 99 is super nice. So those are the 13 cards that we're going to be replacing for the 13 cards that we're taking out. And honestly, this deck looks super fun. We haven't seen a commander before that really cares about cycling, and there are a lot of really cool interactions, and I'm super excited to pick up this deck and play it. Not to mention that there are some really expensive cards in the deck, like Fierce Guardianship. It's the most expensive card in any of the precons so far for Ikoria. And there are a lot of other really cool things in the deck. If there are any other cards that you would put in that maybe I missed, or other cards that you would take out, feel free to let me know down in the comment section. I'm not the best deck builder. I just build decks how I think they'd be fun to play and how I think that they would work efficiently. So I'd love to hear your guys' feedback on ideas, maybe things I didn't even think of. It'd be super cool to know that. I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and if you haven't hit that subscribe button yet, it'd mean a lot to us if you did. That way you stay on track with our future deck techs for the other legendary creatures in the Ikoria standard set and the other legendary creatures in these precons that we're going to be building decks for, and so you don't miss our future gameplay videos where we're actually going to be playing these precon decks against each other. And additionally, we're going to be playing the decks that we build for these legendary creatures against each other later on in the year. So thank you guys so much for watching this video. We really appreciate it, and I hope you guys have a great day.